has a promise for you. You know, we serve a big God. And we're going to talk about Canaan, right? I mean, about Caleb, right? And Joshua a little bit. And, you know, if God is giving you something, if you're going through hard times, let's just say, if you're going through tough times, struggles right now, be in victory. Be joyful. Give him all your praise, because you're going through this, because he's got something. You're going to fight for what he's going to give you. He's going to give you something wonderful, and you're going to fight. You're going to go into the land, and you're going to search. You're going to search. And God, when he tells you to go, you're going to go. You're not going to make excuses. You're not going to say, I can't because of the circumstance. I have this dream, and I always wanted to be this, you know, I always wanted to do this. I always wanted to open this business. I always wanted to do whatever it is in your heart. You know, when you give your heart to the Lord, he puts his desires in your heart. So you have this heart. You have this dream to do this thing. But you see the circumstance. You see that there's no money for that dream to come true. You see that the situation, that there's too many giants in the land, and there's no way, right? But you know what? God didn't say that. You know, he's preparing you. If you're not ready for it, he's not ready to give it to you. You got to get ready for it, right? You got to be ready. You got to be ready to handle what he's going to give you. You're not going to go and squander it like, you know, the prodigal son did. Just ask for your inheritance and just go squander it. You're going to walk in the fullness, and you're going to seek God even when it looks like everything is coming against you. Nothing is going your way. It's a struggle. You know what? That's a lie from the devil. What is that saying? The struggle is real. That's a lie from the devil. The struggle is not real. Jesus Christ is real, and he came to set the captives free. He came to remove bondages and break strongholds. He came so that you can have life and have it to the full. He didn't come so you could struggle. You're struggling because you want to struggle. Because your circumstances, your situation, sometimes we're so quick to blame God, you know. I was in captivity for a long time. Praise God, he set me free, right? He set me free. Did he set just me free? Anybody else get set free? I got free. I'm free. Praise God. I'm not in captivity. I'm not in bondage. But did I choose that life? Yes, I chose it. Did horrible things happen? Yes, horrible things happened. Whose fault was that? That was my fault. I went through places that he told me, don't go there, don't do this. He said, meditate on my word day and night, right? And I will give you this. Did I do that? I did not. I ran as far away from his word as possible. And God, he has something for you. I don't want you guys to be discouraged. I want you guys to know, if you're walking through hard times, it's because God has something just so wonderful. You're at the verge of your breakthrough. You don't even know how close you are. I remember I had a dream one time, and I went through these. This was many years ago, and I always remember that dream because it was so real. I was on lily pads going through this body of water, right? And I'm on lily pads, and I'm going, and I ran out of lily pads, and I didn't. There was water now, and I had to get in the water, and I don't know how to swim, so I was afraid. And I said, forget it. I literally was like, I'm going down. And I turned around, and I seen how far I had come. It was such a long way. The distance to where I had to get was so short. And all I had to do was just jump in the water and trust God. But I wanted to turn around, and when I seen how far I had to walk back, it wasn't worth it. And it gave me such peace knowing that God is going to do it. You know, you're right there at the verge. He was telling me, you're right there already. And there were certain situations going on. And you know what? He gave me a warning. He showed that was like a warning dream. This is what's going to happen around that time when you run out of those lily pads. Don't worry about it. Keep going. Just jump in the water. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about, you know, anything. Don't worry about if you don't have enough or if you, All he needs is two. That's it. And if he has more, and that's the thing, he sent 12 spies. He sent 12 spies. And you know what? I'm just going to say he sent 12 spies. I'm going to go down to verse 25. So we're on chapter 13 of Numbers, verse 25. And so remember that in verse 3, in verse 1, God had said that he was sending them, right? He was going to send them. And it says in verse 25, and they returned from searching the land. He sent them into this land, and he told them, go check out that land. And he told them what to look for. He told them to look at the people, look at, you know, what they have, look at, you know, how great the people or how small the people. You know, he just said, go spy out the land, right? So he sent 12 people, one from every tribe, right? Because there's 12 tribes. He sent one from every tribe. So they go out there, and they're spying out the land. And then they came back after 40 days. And 40 is such a significant number in the Word of God. So after 40 days, they come back from searching the land. And then if you go down to verse 27, it says, and they told him and said, we came unto the land whither thou sentest us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. So he wants to send you to a land flowing with milk and honey. He wants to send you to a land with more than enough. Like you won't even want for anything. Your God will supply all your need according to his riches and his glory. But we have to trust him, right? Because without faith, it's impossible to please God, right? So you have to have the faith, right? And if he told you to do it, you got to do it, right? You can't be afraid of the giant. So nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land. We're in verse 28. And the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak, the Amalekites, the Hittites, Jebusites, Amorites, Canaanites. They were all there, right? I'm going to come back to verse 30, but in verse 33, he says, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. So they were so afraid because these people in that land, they were giants. You know, they came from the Nephilim, right? The giants, right? So they were, right, Thea? They were big. So they're giants in the land, and they're afraid. They're like, none of them. He sent 12. They're all like, we don't want to go back. It's not worth it. We're going to go into a land, and we're going to be defeated and, you know, possibly killed and, you know, whatever, you know. We're looking at the circumstance, but God told you to go. But you're like, I don't think so, God. I think you might have made a mistake. Maybe Moses made a mistake in giving the word. You know, maybe he missed it. And you know, we don't know, right? But God said what he said. He said what he said, and he said obedience. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Obey, trust and obey, right? And in verse 30, I'm going back to 30, it says, and Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess, for we are all well able to overcome. That's Caleb. There's 12 people. And Caleb said that, but the men that went up against them said, we will not be able to go up against them. So they're like fighting, you know, like, we're going to go up. And they're like, no, we can't go up. You know what? They were so afraid. It says in chapter 14, verse 2, and all the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron, and the whole congregation said unto them, would God that we would have died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in the wilderness. I am so glad I didn't die in the wilderness. I'm so glad that I didn't die in the wilderness. Don't give up hope in your wilderness. Your wilderness is going to equip you. You're being equipped. God is training you. He's teaching you. Lord, teach my hands to war and my fingers to fight. Right? So he is teaching you. Don't give up. Don't say, I wish I would have. I know we've all been through that. I don't know. Maybe I'm the only one. I would be like, Lord, I just want to go home now. guys are seated with Christ in heavenly places. You're overcomers by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. God, you are sanctified. You are set free. You are still filled with the Spirit of God. You know, God, you are greatly loved by God. Did you know that? You are great. You are His ambassador. You are His chosen people. You're a city on a hill. You're the salt and light of the earth. He loves you, absolutely loves you. If it was just you, He would have died for just you. He loves you. It says, for God so loved the world, this world that rejects Him, this world that's turned its back on Him and persecutes His people, this world, God, He loves this world. He loves this world. That He gave His only Son. I don't know anybody that would give their only Son. I don't know. He gave His only Son to die so that we could have eternal life. He made it that easy for us, and we reject Him. He made it so simple. All you got to do is believe in the Lord your God, and you shall be saved and your house. Right? He made it that easy. Just say, Lord, I believe you. I believe you died on the cross, Lord God. I believe you rose on the third day. And I surrender to you, Lord God. Have your way in me. Forgive me. I repent. That's all He wants. And He made it that easy that He would send His Son as that one sacrifice so that we wouldn't have to sacrifice. There's life in the blood. That's why, you know, when you guys be ordering your steaks, order them well done. There is life in the blood. And, you know, He says, do not eat the blood. There's life in the blood. The blood is for sacrifice. The blood, you know, that's for sacrifice, right? We are the, we surrender ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable and pleasing unto God, right? We are His creation, called by His name. He created us for a purpose. And don't you think, like, what if, you know, the creator of the car created the car and we're like walking it around and pushing it, you know, doing all these unnecessary things that we wouldn't have to do. And the creator of the car is like, get in the car and let it drive you, right? And we make it so hard. God made us for a purpose. We're fearfully and wonderfully made. We're made in His image. We have power and authority. He said, I've given you power and authority to trample on snakes and scorpions. Nothing by any means will harm you. And you have to believe that. You have to say, I believe it, Lord God. And when you start to doubt, ask God to forgive you and to increase your faith. Remember, He resists the proud. He gives grace to the humble. Right? So then all these people, you know, they wanted to die in their wilderness. And it says in verse 3, wait, did I read verse 3? Oh, and wherefore hath the Lord brought us unto this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and our children should be prey? Were it be not better for us to return into Egypt? We want to go back. You want to return to your vomit? No, thank you. You don't want to go back. You want to go forward. You never want to go back. Say, I never want to go back. I never want to go back. Never, right? You want to keep going. You want to be led by the Lord, right? He said that His sheep hear His voice and they know Him, right? And they follow Him. So we are led by the Lord, right? So we don't want to go back to Egypt. Who cares if they had onions and leeks and all these things that they were crying about? We ain't impressed with that. We've been there. We've done that. We want the greater things, right? The greater things. He said, you will do greater things than these, right? It says in verse 4, and they said to one to another, let us make a captain, and let us return into Egypt. Let us make a captain, and let us return unto Egypt. Okay? They want to split that congregation. They're like, let us make a captain, and we're going to return to Egypt, and we're going to go back instead of going forward. We're not going to go forward with them. No, we are not. We refuse to go forward with them. You know, that's how people get. They get set in spirit of sorcery, that spirit of division, discord, arguing, bickering. We don't want that. That is not of God. That is not of the Lord. So in verse 6 it says, "And Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes." So Joshua and Caleb were like, they were repenting before the Lord on behalf of all of this, right? They're upset. They're coming before God. They that was the way of them, repenting, right? So it says, "And they spake unto all the congregation," all the company of the children of Israel, saying, "The land which we pass through to search it is an exceedingly good land." Like, they're determined. They see it. They see it. They're like, this is a good land. We have to stay in this land. And so they said that they have to stay in the land, right? It's a good land. In verse 8, it says, "If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which floweth with milk and honey." Right? So he said, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he's going to give it to us. Don't be worried about it. Don't be worried about what's going on or if you can handle the giants in the land. Don't be worried about it. God is so good. Oh my gosh, God has greater things. God is doing greater things. What that tells me right there is the 10, it was 12, right? 10 of them were looking at the giants and feeling so defeated by the giants. All these giants of debt, giants of lack, insufficiency, giants of discord, giants of problems, giants of whatever is going on in your life. Giants in your neighborhood, those giants in the city you live in, and the giants governing the nation. That's what they were looking at, right? The giants. But Caleb and Joshua, they were looking at God. They were like, my God is bigger than those giants, and we're going to go in there, and we're going to recover everything. Don't you worry about it. God's got us. If he be for us, who can be against us, right? And they were looking at the bigness of their God while the other 10 were looking at the bigness of the giants, right? So who was getting glory there, right? Satan, right? Because he's having them look at the problem and look at the situation. Look at the situation. You're never gonna have that house. You're never going to have that car. You're never going to be able to afford this or that. You're never going to be able to, you're struggling and you're going through hardships, and he's telling you just how hard it is. And you're feeling defeated every day, and you can't even smile, right? But that's not what God wants. He wants us to praise him. That's where our breakthrough is. When we start pressing in and praising him and singing and dancing, those chains are being broken, those strongholds are being removed, and God is just moving, right? That's how he works. He ain't going to work on somebody just sitting there looking defeated, and they don't have no, you can't do nothing. He can't work with them. But with your praise, he can work with that situation. Your praise moves the hand of God. So you just have to be excited and just praise him. It says in verse 9, "Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are brethren." Now this is Caleb and Jonathan talking. "I'll eat them for breakfast." They ain't nothing. They're bread for us, right? He's looking at it through the have our eyes on God. We have to be focused. Meditate on His word day and night. Know that He is our provider. Know that He said He has so many promises, right? In His word about how He's going to take care of us, right? He's a good God. He's not going to bring you this far to leave you. He's brought you. It's by His grace that you come this far, right? And it says in verse 23, surely they shall not see the land which I swear unto them. Now they made a man. He's like, neither shall any of them that provoke me see. They provoked him to leave. Now he's like, they ain't gonna see. But my servant Caleb, because he had another spirit within him, and he followed and has followed me fully with him, I will bring him to the land whereunto he went, and his seed shall possess it, right? Even our seed is going to possess it, right? He wants us to prosper, and He wants our children to prosper, right? He is so awesome. He's a mighty working, miracle-working God. It says in verse 37, even those men that did bring up the evil report upon the land died by plague before the Lord. They didn't succeed because they didn't trust God. Because we don't trust God, we open the doors to other things. You know, I'm not gonna go and pray to God. Instead, I'm gonna go, you know, I need healing, but I don't know if God's gonna heal me. I've been asking Him. I'm just gonna go to this curandera and, you know, just let them do whatever they're gonna do. Or, you know, I need deliverance, but I ain't gonna go and get deliverance. I'm just gonna go to this person and get an idea. And, you know, I want to hear from, I want to know what's going to happen in this situation, but I'm not going to go to church and I'm not going to get in the Word. Instead, I'm going to go to this psychic over here and let them, you know. And you're opening all these doors and you're going through unnecessary hardships and you're opening these doors and you're believing these lies of the devil. And then there's all this anger and bitterness starts to set in. Do you know that that causes disease and sickness and infirmity? We can't let those things fester in us, right? Science will tell you that. If you don't believe God, listen to the facts, right? God is the facts. Listen to the word of God. He's your healer. And He wants to do great things for you. And He just needs you to believe that and trust and obey. Okay. Just keep listening. Keep hearing. You know what? You need to go on a fast to hear Him more clearly, then go on a fast, right? If you need to go on a fast to break some of these strongholds out for your life, then do that, you know? Meditate on His word and let Him guide you. And don't be afraid of what He has for you. Don't put limitations and barriers on yourself. Watch God. Watch Him move in your life. And that's really the message that I have for you guys. Not be afraid to possess the land. Don't be so quick to run away. Don't run away. If God tells you go here, you go here. If God tells you go there, and you trust Him, and you let Him use you. Don't return to your bondage. Don't go back to Egypt. Don't do any of that. Just stay firm, rooted, grounded, unmovable, unshakable, always abounding, right? He wants to be firm. Never wavering. A double-minded man is unstable in all his. We have to be firm, and we can't let that. We just have to keep pressing forward to the mark of the higher calling of God in Christ Jesus, and watch Him move you, and you're going to go from glory to glory and faith to faith. Like, you're going to be like, He did that for me, and your faith is going to increase. He's going to do so much more for you. He's going to do exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or think, right? So just keep trusting God, and praise God. That's my message, you guys. I don't want to keep you guys long. You guys, it's nice. So let's we'll close in prayer. Thank you, Father. And then we'll close in prayer. Thank you, Father God, for the word. We glorify You. We worship You, God. We pray that it didn't fall on deaf ears. We pray, Father God, that seed, Father God, that you will give the increase. In the name of Jesus, that even if there's two people, Father God, that received it, Lord God, that You would increase them, multiply them, Father God, and whoever wants to go forward and do Father God, that you take them through leaps and bounds and that you just catapult them into the new, Father God. You have new things. You are doing a new thing. You said, Father God, you are doing a new thing, Lord God, and watch it spring forth. So we trust you and we believe you, God, and we worship you today in Jesus' mighty name.